We'll open up eventually a little more as we make our plans anticipating the next phase of the provincial reopening. We expect that we will still be wearing masks for indoor worship, although a portion of the sanctuary will be available for masks and no distancing, but a portion of the sanctuary will still allow for masks and distancing. And we'll move into some more singing, we hope, with the addition of our choir. And the expectation will be that people will be fully vaccinated to attend in-person worship. Otherwise, people are welcome to participate through our online and live streaming services. But it remains to be seen whether or not those reopening plans will take place. So we all live in hope, right? So that's hopefully coming up in a week or so. But next Sunday is World Communion Sunday. That's Sunday, October the 3rd, and we will be celebrating communion here as a Woodlawn United Church at the 10 a.m. service. And it's advised that if you choose to participate in communion, to please bring your own bread and juice at this time, and bring those in containers that you can also take with you afterwards. Some other announcements to share with you. There's a covenanting service this evening at Orchard Valley United Church in New Minas for Katie Logan. Katie, our former youth coordinator, is beginning her ministry with the people of Orchard Valley, and so we certainly wish her the best and the pastoral charge the best as they begin that new pastoral relationship. There's a request for donations to decorate the chancel for Thanksgiving. There's details about that in the bulletin. Next Sunday is our food bank Sunday, being the first Sunday of the month, and there is a special request for instant coffee and cereal. So please keep that in mind. UCW has some gift jars that they're preparing to sell. I hate to say that it's just in time for Christmas gift giving, because I really don't want to go to Christmas yet. But those jars are certainly available. And there's a Bible study that will be beginning on the second Friday of October. So if you are interested, I've already had a few people register, and if you would like to register as we take a look at the book of Genesis, please email me or the office so that you can be included in that as we continue to find ways to be the church through this pandemic time. And October the 17th, following an abbreviated worship here in the sanctuary, the transition team will be having an open space time, a time when we're really encouraging members of the congregation to come together as we consider, you know, the work of transitional ministry, the goals that have been set out, what those goals look like, and how we might achieve them together. So please mark that on your calendar for October the 17th following worship. Another big announcement, I guess, for those who had chowder yesterday, you know that there was a big chowder luncheon takeout that took place. And it was big, and there was a lot of chowder sold. And a big thank you goes out to Ralph Sams and to his team. I think we can offer an applause to them and all those volunteers for the good work they did and the good chowder they provided, and to everyone who contributed to make that such a great event. I saw somewhere that it's hoped there will be another chowder luncheon on October the 29th, so pencil that in, and hopefully that will happen. If you do not receive the email announcements and the bulletin that goes out each week, please let the office know so we can include you in our weekly communications, and thank you for the way you continue to support Woodlawn United Church. Through volunteering, through reaching out to one another, through your financial gifts, all make a big difference as we continue to seek and be and do the work of the church in our day and age with the many challenges that continue to remain before us. But we persevere by faith. And as we gather, we celebrate and give thanks for this faith. And so please I invite you to say the responses to our call to worship this morning. Come with what you have, for you who come with gladness, know that your melody will find harmony. Accepting God's love for us, we are called to love one another. Come with what you have, for you weighed down by too many shoulds and what ifs. Know that here you may lay down these burdens. Loved by one another, we discover God's love for us. Come with what you have. For you who have the answers, know that new questions await you. Accepting God's love for us, we are called to love one another. Come with what you have. For you who come seeking, know that your questions are safe in the presence of God. Loved by one another, we discover God's love for us. And so I invite you to stand as you are able, and I invite you to sing along softly or to hum along to the words of our opening hymn, Come Let Us Sing. I invite you to be seated. When God's Spirit brooded over the waters of creation, God spoke and said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And again, God speaks to us in the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ, the one who comes as the light of the world, with a light meant to shine in us, and a light meant to shine for us, illuminating the way to everlasting life. I invite us into a time of prayer as we welcome God's presence in this place. So may we bow our heads and breathe deeply. Invite some sacred silence. And let us pray. O Lord our God, where is there another God like you? A God of justice and unfailing love, who stands by every promise made to his people generation after generation. There is no other. You alone are God. And so we gather together to worship you, to give you thanks, to proclaim your greatness, to sing your praise, to seek your face, to celebrate your faithful presence with us and how you have been made known to us through Christ Jesus. We pray that your Spirit would guide and inspire our worship this day, that we might sing and speak your praise, that our ears might be open to hear your word, your eyes to see you at work in this world, and our hearts open to receive your love. And so in this time of worship, we offer ourselves to you again In the name of Christ, the one who teaches us and others to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our reading today is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans. This text takes on an issue that had been creating division between the church community, specifically the issue of eating meat that was being sold in the Roman marketplaces. The members were judging one another according to the meat they did or did not eat. Instead of loving one another, they were questioning and doubting because they were not like each other. A reading from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 to 13. Welcome to those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who must eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. For those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. And also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then each of us will be accountable to God. Let us therefore no longer pass judgment on one another, but resolve instead never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of another. May God bless these words unto our hearts and our understanding.
Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we gather in this sanctuary, we open our hearts to you in prayer, we offer you songs of praise. And now, as we reflect on these words of Scripture read for us this day, we open up our hearts to you and pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable unto you and contain for us the word of life, the same life we encounter in Christ Jesus, for it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Well, now and then, every time I'll be watching television and I'll be flipping through the channels. And sometimes I end up on one of those competitive cooking shows on the Food Network. And if you've ever seen them, you know the one that I'm talking about. A number of chefs are given a basket of ingredients to make a dish that will wow the judges. And it's a competitive frenzy between the chefs and the contestants. They have to come up with a dish that not only tastes good, they have to do it in a set amount of time while the judges offer this running commentary of what's going on. And then once that clock, it counts down to zero, well, that frenzy of activity stops. And then the show, it shifts to this more subdued atmosphere when they enter this time, and I love this phrase, the time of tasting and judging. Well, for the most part, I've noticed that the judges like cooks that are like them and do the things that they would do. But there was this one time when I was watching the tasting and judging. And as one of the judges addressed one of the competitors, she said, "You know, the whole time as I was watching you prepare your dish, I sat here shaking my head. I did not like what you were doing. It wasn't what I would have done." And then she said, "But after tasting your dish, I realized I may not have liked what you were doing, but I love your dish." You know, as I listened to that, I said to myself, wow, you know, whoever thought I would have encountered such profundity on the Food Network, but there it was. I may not have liked it, but I loved it. You see, as many of us know, but sometimes forget, and I was reminded of it when that judge said those words, there is a difference between liking something and loving it. Just as there is a difference between liking a person and loving them. I mean, as a people of faith and as a church, it's important for us to be able to distinguish and name this difference. I mean, after all, Jesus didn't leave his disciples with the commandment to like one another as I have liked you. His new commandment was to love one another. In fact, Jesus, he never admitted to liking his disciples. But you know, in our world and even in our church, we can put a great emphasis on liking something or someone. I mean, we can put a great emphasis on being liked. We like to give ourselves a stamp of approval or have others put their stamp of approval on us, right? With such this big emphasis on being liked and being alike. It's easy to forget about love. And this is something the Apostle Paul addresses in this text Kelly read for us this morning. I mean, we might say there was some tasting and judging going on in the church in Rome. There were ones who didn't like what others were doing. And the issue had to do with eating meat, of all things, right? There were members of the church whose eating habits were not like the eating habits of other people in the church. To be clear, this isn't a debate about the benefits or drawbacks of being a vegetarian. That's not what this text is about. Paul isn't disparaging a vegan lifestyle when he says the weak only eat vegetables or eat only vegetables. There's something else going on here. And it has to do with the meat that was for sale in Roman marketplaces. You see, at the beginning of each day in Rome, it was common for the pagan priests to go down to the markets and bless the meat that was being sold, right? They would do that in the name of the pagan gods each morning. I guess it was good for business, some kind of endorsement. Right? Instead of, you know, maple leaf sausages and Schneider's ham, you go into a Rome marketplace and there would be Jupiter lamb shakes and Apollo tenderloin or something, right? But there were members of the Roman church that didn't like those brands. They believed that if they ate meat that had some other god's name on it, it would have ill effects. But, you know, at the same time, there were members of the church in Rome and said, well, that's just superstitious. It's just meat. Of course you can eat it. Right? When Paul says the weak eat only vegetables, it's because the ones who would not eat that meat from the marketplaces believed that the pagan gods still had power over them. Right? They didn't understand how safe and complete they were in Christ. That they believed that pagan gods had some power and that if they ate this meat, they would end up sick or with some sort of curse, right? It was a superstition. Right? And this is what Paul says to the members of the church who had decided to judge these ones who would not eat meat. The ones who didn't like what these other members were doing because they weren't like them in eating meat. Paul says those who eat meat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. In other words, Paul's saying, you know, just because you don't approve, just because you're not alike, it doesn't give you a license to judge in terms of who anyone is in the eyes of God. As Paul says, you know, it is before their own Lord they stand and fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Paul knew ones who had come into the church. You know, he knew that those ones who came into the Roman church who were different. They weren't welcomed into the church in order that they might be judged as in or out, or in order that they could receive a stamp of approval that says, you know, we like you when you are like us, and that's what matters. That's not why they came to be a part of the church. The church was a place where first and foremost people would come and experience the love of God. You see, in Paul's world, as in our world, too often we put a greater emphasis on being liked and being alike than we do love. I mean, there's a lot of division that comes, a lot of conflict that comes because of this politics of difference. You know, it could be based on things like culture, language, race, creed, gender. But especially, it seems sometimes, just personal preference. Right? On a daily basis, we're reminded that there are people who are not like us. And chances are that as a result, because they're not like us, we can judge them. We do judge them. We can say we don't like them. And being like, you know, that's important. It's important to a lot of people. Just ask anyone who posts something on Facebook or somewhere and then checks back regularly to see how many people have liked it. You see, the power of like, it has to do with being accepted, a sense of belonging, or not being accepted and not belonging. I mean, we're invited to make judgments on what we like and what we don't like all the time. Right, we're reminded that people will not always like what we like and that there will be differences. I mean, this pandemic time, you know, with its stresses, just every day, I think it continues to reveal new differences. There's just a great deal of judging that continues to go on and on. And as we see in the church, and this is what Paul's seeking to address, in the midst of such judgment, human relationships get pulled apart. People become divided into camps, into clubs, and into cliques. And we express our disapproval and feel as if maybe we don't belong or that others don't belong. As a people of faith, the power of like over love is an energy we need to contend with. And we need to, because it so easily creeps into our lives and into the life of the church. I mean, I was reading this one author, Israel Kamuzandu, a New Testament scholar. And he was reflecting on what happens in churches when the desire to welcome people ends up being colored by a desire to have people who are just like us. He says, in sociological, theological, political, and cultural ways, today's church is one that's sadly characterized by hostility. And that if 21st century Christians looked in a divine mirror, they would be astonished to discover the ways they describe people as being insiders or outsiders. And I tend to agree with them. I mean, in fact, you know, over the years, I've witnessed hostility in churches because of all sorts of strange differences. And some not so strange, but, you know, preferences around what hymns are sung, how the offering is collected, how communion is served, what the minister wears, what style of worship we choose. The list can go on. And it happens because we choose like over love. We can end up saying things along the lines of, well, I like the way things are, you know, I like what I like. And what I like are the way things should be. It's the attitude that says, you know, if you don't like the things I like, then I don't like you. And why? Well, I believe that, you know, it's because most of us believe this, and it's true at one level, that life's just easier when people are like me or like us. I mean, having to be around people who are different, perhaps even a different culture or a different class or with different preferences, you know, that can be work. Right? The ones, you know, we refer to as those people or them, the ones who can make life challenging. I mean, life's just easier when I'm surrounded by people who are like me and when I'm with people who like the things I like. You don't have to watch what you say. You know, you don't have to worry about what you eat, so on. It's easy. But you see, we can fool ourselves into believing in a false reality of sameness. And our world can become very small. We live for ourselves and the things and the people we like. But we can do a lot of damage in the process. I mean, consider, you know, here we are with the Truth and Reconciliation Day on the horizon. And think about those residential schools that were, as much as anything, an attempt to take a people who weren't like us and make them to be like us. And I hope and pray that this ongoing process of truth and reconciliation, although it cannot undo past wrongs, might help us to move beyond that kind of thinking and behavior, lest we end up making similar mistakes. And as the Apostle Paul says, you know, we do not live for ourselves and we do not die to ourselves. Whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. Right? We acknowledge that we live in this realm of God's kingdom, a realm that moves us beyond personal preferences, moves us beyond culture, to instead know the fullness of God's love in the diversity that God has created. Right? It's not about sameness, it's about diversity. I mean, we may all share this common bond of Creator, but we are not all alike. As Christians, if we're dedicated to knowing Jesus Christ, this means knowing other people, ones who are not like us. And there's a good illustration of this given by C.S. Lewis in his book, The Four Loves. And he tells this story about friendship. And there were these three friends named Charles and Jack and Ronald. And the three were very, very close friends. But sadly and tragically, one day, Charles dies. And Jack, in self-consolation, he's sad that Charles is gone, but he says, well, at least I'll now have more time with Ronald now that Charles is gone. But what Jack noticed was that after Charles had died, that Ronald wasn't the same person. And that, you see, Charles had brought out a side of Ronald that was no longer there. And Jack realized that after losing Charles, he had actually lost Ronald too. And he began to think and he began to see how it actually takes a varied community of people in order to come to know one person well. And Lewis's point was, you know, if that's true of a regular person, then how much more true it must be of Jesus Christ. You see, every one of us has this possibility of seeing some truth and some beauty and some of the qualities of Christ, that we can all see something differently, understand the implications of the gospel differently, but it's only together that we can begin to piece together the fullness of the kingdom of God. So what does it mean? It means that even though, you know, it can be hard work to be with people who are not like us and whose sensitivities are different from us, we come to know God more fully through them. As one theologian I read put it, he says, "Resist the temptation to hang out with people who are just like you. You'll never see all of Christ, and you'll never see the fullness of the gospel." We need to go back to the first word from our text today. You remember the word? The word that Paul uses is translated as welcome. And the word welcome, you know, it can also be understood here as to accept, to lift up, to partake. And it's not about tolerating another. It's about being in a relationship and loving another. I mean, you see, tolerance, I mean, it's about having your opinions and me having my opinions. You stay over there and I'll stay here, right? We'll just tolerate. There's still division. There's still a lack of communication. But the word Paul uses is this Greek word for welcome, and it's participatory. It involves a relationship with ones who are different from you. When Paul says, welcome those who are weak, he's acknowledging the difference, but knows that we are more than our differences. That there is something else that in faith that is meant to unite us, even while we judge differences. As Paul says, for we all stand before the judgment seat of God, and each of us is accountable to God. I mean, you see, we may want to accept people on our own terms and according to the things we like. But what we all need to remember is that we have all been accepted on God's terms unconditionally. I mean, that's what the love of God is. That's what the Christ of cross represents. It's the work that is done. It's the judgment seat of God. Yes, on one level, the cross was the world's judgment of Jesus. The world saying to the Son of God, we don't like you. You're not like us. But in the giving of Christ to the world, God's judgment is not, well, I like you, or I don't like you. God's judgment is, I love you. It's the judgment of the one who did not live for himself or die for himself, but died for others in order to show that this kind of love brings life, brings us into resurrection, brings us into the realm of God where we all belong. You see, the fullness of Christ on the cross shows the possibility of the gospel, the possibility of getting beyond the things this world likes and doesn't like, to know instead the desire of a love of a God who desires life for all, even you and me. You know, it's like something I encountered in a conversation I had not that long ago. I stopped at a grocery store to do some shopping, and I neglected to pick up a basket on the way in, and inevitably I ended up walking around with more than I could handle. And I was in this long checkout line, and I dropped a couple of things on the floor. And well, the guy behind me was nice enough. He said, you know, if you don't mind, I can pick those up for you. And I said, please and thank you, understanding, you know, people can be hesitant with good reason during this pandemic time. And we had a conversation, and, you know, we were talking about the great deal of fear that still exists, the anxiety that has been generated, the differences that have arisen. And at the conclusion of our conversation, he said this. He said, you know, people need to realize that this time won't last forever. And whether they realize it or not, there will be life after COVID. And how we treat each other now will determine what that life will be like. Well, I left the store that day and I said, wow, whoever thought I would encounter that kind of profundity in the checkout line at No Frills. But it's so true. For what we need to remember, and this is something Paul wanted those members of the church to remember, that beyond the present moment, beyond differences, beyond preferences, and our likes and our dislikes, there is a life to come. And as a people of faith, we've been given the gift of love to shape that life. A love that allows us to follow the one who did not live for himself or die for himself. A love that welcomes us and upholds us. A love that anticipates and prepares for the life yet to come. A love that is Christ-like. Thanks be to God. Friends, we support the life and the work of the church both here and around the globe. Through what we do as a church, through the talents and gifts that we share, through our financial givings and offerings. So I invite you to stand as we dedicate our offering this day. Let us pray. O Holy One, as we offer our treasure and our hearts to you, may they be used to pass on the promise of hope, of peace, of life, of community, to all in need of your gifts, to those who are like us and to those who are unlike us, in order that they might know the gift of your love and your presence in their lives. Amen. And let us say together the words of a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. I invite you to be seated, that we might turn to God again in prayer, and through this gift, offer the prayers of our hearts, our hopes, our concerns, and that know that God is bigger than our doubts. So may we bow our heads, and let us pray. Eternal God, as we turn to you in prayer this day, Give us the grace and confidence of faith that allows us to place ourselves totally into your hands. In our moments of doubt and in the midst of an insecure world, made all the more insecure when there are disagreements because people aren't like us and we're not like them. And that somehow in the midst of it all, we don't quite believe that you are able or really do care for us. So help us, O God, to open our eyes as the Lord of creation, lift us up and elevate our thinking, that we might set our minds on heavenly things, consider all our relations, including your relationship to us and our relationship to you. Thank you, O God, for being so patient, for hearing our prayers, the ones spoken aloud and the ones too deep for words, the ones we leave with you to answer in accordance with your loving purpose. And so with hearts of thanksgiving, we do lift up gratitude. Gratitude for the gift of loving relationships lived out in families and communities, be them shared with people who are like us or not like us. And help us to remember that it is through this diversity that we are richer, and we behold the fullness of your kingdom. A kingdom that includes creatures great and small, the fullness of creation that surrounds us. In our gratitude, may we discover new ways and the freedom to live with less, to conserve, be better stewards of the earth's resources, that many, many more can enjoy this beautiful garden called earth that has been fashioned so life may flourish. O God of creation, may we be filled with such a sense of gratitude for all that we have, for all that we are, that we may not be limited in our vision, and that we might share this grateful spirit with others, that we might be full of your loving kindness towards the whole of creation, that we might be free to consider the needs of others and to name our concerns and the impossible challenges that need your justice and mercy and grace. And so we lift up to you the names of friends, of loved ones, of strangers and people far away, heartfelt concerns and worries that we carry with us. We pray for ones who suffer alone. We pray for ones whose lives are filled with memories of past wrongs. We pray that where there are wounds, that there may be healing, and that where the truth has been hidden, that the truth of your love may be spoken. Where there is brokenness in our relationships, may there be reconciliation. May we be open to the repentance and to the listening that needs to happen in order for that reconciliation to grow. We hold in our hearts this morning ones dealing with illness, be it physical or mental. We pray for ones awaiting medical treatment or test results. We are mindful this day of ones who grieve, for those who mourn the loss of loved ones, and find themselves lost in the process. We hold this earth in our prayers, O Lord of life, knowing that your heart is in it too, desiring to make all things new. Where there is violence, may there be peace. Where there is destruction, may there be rebuilding. Where there is loneliness, may there be community. And teach us, O God, to remember your mercy in our relationships with others. For you, as one God, holy in three persons, a community of one that has a loving relationship at the core of your being. Inspire each of us to see how we have been built and created in your image, that we might live the life you would have us live with one another and with you, that we might be moved to a higher purpose and a deeper faith, and that we might welcome one another in order that we might love one another as you have loved us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you to stand and reflect on the words of our closing hymn this morning, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." And feet of Christ in this world we share. We each have a ministry to ease the suffering, to live with compassion and build up God's loving peace. As we leave this time of worship, let us encourage one another to share the gifts we have been given. By grace, may we speak the truth, uphold the beauty in others, and embrace the freedom of life in the Spirit. May we go in love, go in peace, go with God. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may our Lord shower you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.